And welcome to QI for an episode which is all about justice. Members of the jury, the just Brian Cox. The judicious Rhys Darby. The judgmental Jason Manford. And the jailbird Alan Davis. Well, in case I nod off during these proceedings, you all know how to catch my attention. It's with a buzzer, and Jason goes. Brian goes.
All rise.
Rhys goes.
Order! Order!
And Alan goes. Excellent. So let's start laying down the law. Describe the rules. Oh, he's free! Escapology.
I'll tell you what, being a copper back then when everyone dressed like I was well easy.
Easy,
I think it might be him. It might be that guy.
You're going to take this off because the bridge of my nose is rubbing.
Oh, you don't want that.
Oh my God, it's Alan Davis.
No, Coward was at a rehearsal when one of the actors was picking his nose. He thought secretly, and Noel shouted, "Wave when you get to the bridge." Anyway, describe the rules on a pirate ship.
Rules?
Yeah. But what sort of rules would they have?
Obviously, they've got a captain.
Yes.
So he's in charge. So I imagine he gets most of the gold and whatever they find.
Well, oddly enough, now, they had two senior officers, the captain and the quartermaster. And the captain could be vetoed by the quartermaster on all matters except battle. Except rules of engagement when fighting. And they had strong laws. And the quartermaster was, he was about how much they divvied out, including he decided how much the captain got. The captain had no special quarters. He didn't have a, you know, wonderful room such as you imagine in movies. So it's not exactly hierarchical. It's kind of a rule of two, the quartermaster and the captain. Otherwise, it was more or less a democracy in a strange sort of way, but with strict rules. For example, in Captain Bartholomew Roberts' ship, the Fortune, and there was no gambling. It was like a boarding school. No smuggling girls into the dorm, no playing music on a Sunday, and lights out at 8 o'clock sharp in the evening.
It's rubbish being a pirate.
I know. It's not quite what you imagine.
It's my dad, the captain.
But where are you going to smuggle these girls from anyway? Well,
that's true.
If you rescue one from the sea, no.
There is a wonderful book that when Vic Reeves was on, he mentioned he was an expert on
piracy.
He loves
the pirate, Vic
Reeves. He loves pirates, and it's a book that both he and I had read called Sodomy and the Piratical Tradition. And so it is a very well-known
book. So sorry, bro.
Of history. No, it is.
So we're quite highbrow and intellectuals.
It is a very serious work of history and very interesting, which goes into the way these things were run. But obviously with the emphasis on the sodomy. But there was also...
And were there rules surrounding that particular pursuit?
there were rules. Indeed, there were. Absolute, very strict rules. You couldn't just take whomever you pleased.
What,
no.
are the rules of sodomy?
Not on Sundays.
It's eye-wateringly complex. Yeah. Right? You're too young and too innocent to know. Okay. Honestly,
For future reference,
stick to small things like supernovas. This is really too explosive.
Eye-wateringly complex.
When it came to women aboard, the articles of Captain George Lowther, who was a famous pirate of his day, said, "If at any time you meet with a prudent woman, that man that offers to meddle with her, without her consent, shall suffer present death." So meddling with a prudent woman without her consent got you death. So they really were very strict with each other.
So meddling was rape, really.
I think essentially we're talking
that
about rape.
Lost its meaning by the time Scooby-Doo came
exactly.
on.
Exactly. Pesky kids haven't meddled.
Notorious gang rapists.
That's just terrible. I'm ashamed of you. I mean, do they have pirates in New Zealand?
We've been attacked by pirates on occasion.
And you didn't have anyone transported to New Zealand like Australia?
No, it was a destination of choice for those seeking adventure and death.
Nothing's changed.
Nothing much has changed, no, exactly.
Why is the pirate voice similar to the farmer's voice? Why? Is there something? Arr! Get off my land!
There's one man responsible. Do you know who it is?
It'll be a film actor.
Yes.
Oh, OK.
Treasure Island.
He played in a great performance of Treasure Island. And in fact, Tony Hancock, the great comedian, he first started out as an impersonator of this actor.
Lawton?
No, not quite as well known as Lawton. In his own day, he was very, very well known, but now less well known.
Anybody?
Someone, we've mentioned on QI before.
Hang on a minute,
the chances getting... of Alan getting... remembering it are.
Someone in the front row saying, you've done this. This was on Dave on Tuesday. New facts.
Yeah, well, it was Robert Newton anyway.
Robert Newton.
Thank you, yes.
Robert Newton
is the right answer, yeah, but it doesn't count because we've had it before.
David Prowse almost did that, didn't he, to Darth Vader? He has a West Country accent, didn't he?
Yes,
and he famously thought that he was going to be used, didn't he?
Yes.
With his West Country accent, he got redone.
I am your James father. Jones.
Very upset.
I'm your father, and I'm your brother as well. Sorry for when I tore there. Joking.
See?
Darth Vader on a big tractor. Yeah. Trundling down the corridors of the Death Star, chewing a bit of straw. Yeah.
Darth.
Mr. Darth to you.
Mr. Darth. Anyway.
You know the skull and crossbone flag?
Yes.
Do they really have that? Because, I mean, that's... Really oh, giving
hell,
it away,
we definitely covered that in the last
series. Oh, really? I must have missed
Alan will tell you all about it.
Go on.
Jolly Roger.
Well, yeah, everyone knows it's coming. Is that a proposition? Maybe later, Alan.
It's been 10 years, Stephen, and I've finally come round to it. It's time for a Jolly Roger. An eye-watering Jolly Roger.
All right, now... What's the difference between a Californian prison and a medieval dungeon? Now you can see we've very cunningly placed the Tower of London, which is a medieval dungeon, or part of it is, next to Alcatraz, which is, of course, a famous Californian prison.
Is it anything to do with the fact that you can't get out? Alcatraz is famous, isn't it, of being like...
Of prison.
No, yeah. Not out of prison.
How do you get out of prison?
Oh, Reece.
If you're popped in a dungeon, you're given manacles, like you had earlier, and you're given board and lodging, essentially. And we go on today about prisoners having to... It's like a hotel. Look how much it costs the government. Well, in the medieval days...
Oh, they made them work.
Not just made them work, they made them pay. They had to pay for their manacles.
Wow.
They had to pay for their foot jives. They had to pay for their everything. They had to pay for their accommodation.
So they had jobs.
Well, no, that was the awful thing. A lot of them, pretty obviously, were not very rich. So what happened was that they usually then ended up in debtor's prison because they couldn't afford to pay the fee.
Is that a picture of the returns desk? I don't like that. These are a nightmare. Yeah. It really hurt.
But, yes, I mean, when they closed the Fleet Prison in the 40s, they discovered some people had been there for 40 years for what was a small debt they couldn't repay. Anyway, the point is, medieval dungeons, you had to pay your fee. And in California, at least in Riverside County, they've reintroduced such a system. Its county jail now charges inmates $140 a day to be in jail. $140.
More than, like, a Premier Inn.
It's more than a Premier Inn. That's more than Lenny Henry pays to stay in hotels. So that is quite a lot of money. Yes, and County Council...
Then again, there's no table tennis at Premier Inn, so... it's
true. Pamela Walls of the Council noted it may prove hard to collect reimbursements because those defendants who are convicted of crimes and incarcerated typically have limited funds.
What a system.
The supervisor, Jeff Stone, he thinks these are very challenging economic times and it could be a great source of revenue that could return $3 to $5 million a year. But... Unlike in Britain, where you still had to pay, even if you were innocent, at least in California, if you turn out not to have been guilty, you get your money back.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. So.
But, like, where are these people getting their money from? It's from crime, isn't it? So all it's doing is encouraging them to rob more stuff. They think, I'm going into prison, right, I better rob a load of stuff, it's going to cost me a fortune.
They're just about to catch me, I better rush into this shop and take a till. It's true.
They can work once they're in prison, though, can't they? From in prison.
Oh, indeed, in most prisons, yeah. There's work. When I was in prison,
you can set up a little lemonade stand or something in the basketball court, and, you know.
I had to paint soldiers when I was in prison. I was in prison when I was 18.
Toy ones?
There were little toy soldiers.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it was quite sort of relaxing work. Then I was put on the polishing the corridor duty, which was not so pleasant. Oh.
Well, when were you in prison? Yeah. I didn't know you.
Did you not know? Oh, prison. I have a checkered past.
It's a can of worms.
4 years ago now. We've moved on, Brian. We've moved on.
Many people believe I should still be.
You're going to an institution for several years and you come out in debt.
Yeah, I
should say. Rather like being a student.
Yes, exactly. Very well put. That is basically what students
Except you learn probably a lot more in prison than you would.
You learn a trade.
That all sort. You get a trade, you come out with a trade.
Yeah. Useful trade. Bouncing. You learn how to be a bouncer. Don't take this question personally, Alan. I didn't write this question. All right. OK. Now, what sort of person would say that Alan has a very small penis?
I'm sorry.
My wife.
No! And this is a legal question.
It is a very much a legal question, yes.
Oh, OK.
I'll tell you the world of we're in. We're in the world of defamation, right? Let's say I was to write a novel about someone who presented a quiz show called K.I., who was called Simon Dry, and he had a regular sidekick with curly hair who was called Andrew Devons and had a very small penis. The idea is that he'll never sue because he'll never say, this is obviously based on me. Because no one will say, it's obviously based on me because my name's like that and I've got a small... Oh, hang on.
So that's the
idea, is that when you want to slander somebody, you put in certain things that they would never admit to. They'd be too embarrassed to say that it's like them. And there was a writer who was snubbed by Martin Amis, the great novelist. That's Martin Amis there. Peter James was snubbed by him, and he got his own back by creating a character called Amis Smallbone, whose manhood is compared to a stubby pencil. And presumably Martin Amis does not sue.
Was it Martin Amis? Who was it who wrote about Norman Mailer and put a little sort of to the appendix, you know, to the index, because they knew that Norman would always look. And
that was
just said
Norman
Mailer, and it said, yeah, hi, Norm.
That's right. It's a bit like that Jewish joke, isn't it, about the will being read out, you know, and to my brother-in-law, Louis, who always wanted to be mentioned in my will, hello, Louis.
So how do we get away with that as stand-up comedians when someone heckles you and you have a go back and you say something in front of a room of, you know...
Well, it's a kind of understood contract between an audience and a comedian that someone heckles and you go, if I want any shit from you, I'll squeeze your head or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Some
what's that?
So, what
else would you say? What other things?
Just an example. Give away my best heckle remarks. But what I mean is, if you made a joke heckle, that's not defamatory. Okay.
So
I think that's the point.
Tit for tat doesn't stand up in court, does it?
No, I don't think so, exactly.
He started it.
Yeah, exactly. But there are various defences. And in the case, which is obviously an untrue one, of Alan's small penis, for example, one defence is the truth. The person does have a small penis. The other is parliamentary privilege. So a member of parliament can get up and say, Alan Davis, Mr. Speaker, has a small penis. So
another member of parliament can get up and say, he's a grower, not a shower.
The point is, you couldn't sue either of them because under parliamentary privilege, there's no action that could be taken.
There's increased privilege in peer-reviewed scientific journals as well.
Oh, that's privileged?
Yes, it is to some extent.
So that if you're quite rude about a fellow scientist...
Yeah, as long as it's in a peer-reviewed journal and it's not malicious, then you're allowed to do it, in the interest of freedom of debate. I could publish a paper reviewed by my peers about your penis and I would be relatively immune unless I was being malicious about it.
Right. Now, that's the phrase, of course, they use in American defamatory law, is absence of malice. Mm. If you can prove absence of malice, then you can say almost anything.
Yeah. I like your small penis.
Yeah.
it's very, very tiny, but it's wonderful.
Surely, at some point, sarcasm must come in.
Well, there's that, if you can prove that, exactly. So, the other one is good faith. I genuinely thought he had a small penis. I didn't mean it as defamatory. It was said in good faith. That's one thing. The other is opinion. Which is, it was just my opinion. Compared to mine, it's small, OK? Right?
It's a review.
It's a review, exactly.
One star.
The other is the public interest. The public has a right to know the size of Alan Davis's penis. is. That might be a defence. The other is consent. He agreed with me about the size of his penis. The other one is vulgar abuse. Surely you didn't believe me when I said you had a small penis. I was just being rude to you. I was not defaming you. It'd be like if I called you, you know, one of the unacceptable taboo swear words. If I called you a motherfucker, you know, it's not defaming you. Whereas if I actually wrote down that I believed you actually incestuously did have sex with your mother, that would be defamatory. No. So yeah. That's the difference.
Not with a penis that size. No.
That's just going all over the place.
Can we see the evidence? It's all about evidence.
Not from there, it's mind you. Oh,
no. No, Brian.
No, but the first person at home going, I should never have gone HD.
Rise.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you. There is a...
Is this on BBC Three these days?
So sorry, I'm Brian, I know. Anyway, that's the point. Saying a character isn't very well hung could save you from a libel action. Which reality TV format was invented by Charlemagne's father? There's a picture of Charlemagne.
Big Brother?
It's not as well as Big Brother.
Right.
I will give you a clue.
Celebrity Big Brother? On Channel 5.
I'm a king, get me out of here.
That'll cover it. I can tell you it was presented by Dale Winton.
Supermarket Sweep?
No, I...
Got a wife out. What else has he done?
Oh, yeah, you're pretty good. Yeah, you're good.
Yeah, I know the workings.
Big
of...
Big fan.
You're good on Dale.
Yeah.
You probably don't know who Dale Winton is, do you?
Chap or lady?
Audience, hey! He's a very charming gentleman, Mr. Winton. Well turned out. Crisply well turned out gentleman. Very nice man.
Who was his father then?
Charlemagne's father is a good question. Unlikely to have heard of him. I'd be very impressed if you have heard of him. He was called Pepin the Short, unfortunately. But if you go back to this is even pre-medieval, this is Dark Ages. If you go back to that time, justice was meted out in all kinds of odd ways. One of the odd ways it was a system of testing, which was called an ordeal.
An ordeal.
Ordeal. Ordeal. There are various kinds of ordeal.
So it's ordeal or no ordeal.
Oh, no. Yeah. Hey! If only were Noel Edmonds we were talking about, then that would do.
Is he really a lady or a man?
Is Noel Edmonds a man? Well, ordeals. This particular ordeal involved two people had a quarrel, and they both had to make the shape of a cross. See? And stay there. I don't know what that's about.
Someone said he's got a small penis.
Are you a real doctor?
It was called Judicium Crucis, the justice of the cross in Latin. And basically, it's a bit like these school punishments where they make you do that, if you ever did that. The one who just dropped his hands first was wrong. And it happened to the Archbishop of Paris with the abbot of Saint-Denis, and they would use champions to do it for them. So they would say, you on my behalf, stand for as long as you can in the cross. And in this case, the Archbishop of Paris won.
It's a pity you have to nominate someone. Because if you didn't, you could just pick on old people, in those days.
You could have ordeals by tickling. They genuinely had all kinds of ordeals. Ordeals by water, ordeals by fire, and so on. Mm. But there is a car game.
Is it that one where you have got to keep your hand on the car?
Yeah!
Yeah, and then the last one wins it.
You see?
Yeah.
You do know it.
Yes.
Dale Winton presented, I think, on Channel 5, an endurance game show based on a Japanese original called Touch the Truck. That's Dale there.
I'd love to watch that. That's just him. Loads of people touching a car and then that's it.
Yeah.
For an hour.
For an hour? 81 hours.
It's well, because Sky Plus it and fast forward through it.
It's basically the last one to give up on touching the truck.
But it doesn't do anything. You just stand there.
No, you have to touch it.
Yeah, it's going 80 miles an hour. That's a game show.
You were allowed to... You were allowed a 10-minute break every 2 hours and 15 minutes every 6 hours.
This is made up, isn't it?
If you fell asleep, you were disqualified, so you had to stay awake. You couldn't just lie on the car with your hand on it. So you had to be consciously touching it. And if the idea was the last person left touching it won it. Mm. And the winner, you probably want to know all about him, I expect, he won the truck, obviously, yeah. And he sold it in order to raise funds to stand as a political...
For arm surgery. No.
To stand as a political candidate. He stood for Kingston and Surbiton at the 2001 general election. There was a turnout of 49,093 people, and he secured 54 votes.
Wow. We do it in New Zealand. It's a radio show contest. It quite often happens. Yeah, we're probably the last country still doing it. It's the only way you can get your cars back in New Zealand.
Doing it on radio sounds even weirder to me, I have to say.
Still touching it? They're still touching it?
Do you have to drop it?
No, they interview the people who are touching the car. So right. I've got John here. How's it going? Oh, good, I'm still touching it, you know. How many hours now? Seven.
Anyway. That's it. That's basically a game show inspired by a Dark Ages...
Endurance
test, yeah. Extraordinary, isn't it? What sentence would you recommend in Jedwood justice?
Life.
I feel very sorry, Ever Reese. We're giving you all kinds of cultural references that can mean nothing to you. Have you heard of Jedwood?
Yeah. Are they judges? They look they very
are,
young.
I believe yeah. Irish. Are they twins?
They can join twin judges.
They're not conjoined.
Well, they've done well, haven't they?
That's the whole thing about, that's the whole point of them.
They're conjoined.
Are they? They're conjoined twins, yeah.
No, it looks like they are.
You didn't do it, Josh, come on.
Who has the arm in the middle?
They do look a little strange, I have to say, but that's probably because of the wig business.
No, no. Nothing to do with the wig.
Okay. But anyway, there really is such a thing as Jedwood justice. This predates these twinsters.
Maybe that's yeah. where they got the name from, really.
Oh, I don't think so, really. This is a town which was originally called Jedwood, and then it changed its name to Jedburgh. It still exists. Jedburgh, you may have heard of it.
In the northeast.
It is. It's on the borders, in fact. It's a border town, and that's the clue, really. The borders, as you know, suffered throughout history. Incursions and raids and from England, raiding through Scotland, stealing, and vice versa. And they were often summarily hanged without a trial, and it was known as Jedwood justice. And our name for that, where someone is especially killed without a trial, is what word do we use for that?
Oh, lynch mob.
Lynch. Now, where does the word lynch, why is it called lynch?
I have absolutely no idea.
Well, there's a claim to the origin of the term lynch, which is a man called James Lynch Fitzstephen, who was the mayor of Galway in Ireland. And he hanged his own son from the balcony of his house after convicting him of the murder of a Spanish visitor in 1493. Wow. So that's pretty bold, isn't it?
Wow. It's on a bike.
It's extreme. He learned his lesson. He never did it again. No.
Did he say hang his own son for stealing a bike?
No.
No!
What did you think I said?
I misheard you because I'm so hungry. I can't concentrate when I'm hungry.
Killing a Spaniard.
Killing a Spanish visitor, yes, Spaniard.
Do you not listen to
No, he doesn't.
No, I'm starving, hungry. And now I can't concentrate because I'm having a blood sugar crash.
I never get called up for jury service and you're hungry in the afternoon. What was it, kill a Spaniard or stole a bike?
Quite an important difference.
Starving. Yeah, can I get an apple?
Where did that come from?
I don't know.
Stole a bike.
Your mind was wandering.
Up, I was thinking about pasta.
When his brain sugar drops, I'm afraid all kinds of weird things start to happen.
Well, has no one got something to eat here? Can we not?
Are you bringing something down?
Here you go. Come on.
Thank you very much.
Flapjack.
Oh, flapjack! Oh,
thank you. Yeah, go on.
Oh, she had them kids. There we go.
You got something to eat for Stephen as well?
No, no, I'm fine.
When was a bicycle invented? It wasn't invented in 1493, was it? So it's doubly
ridiculous. In fact, questioning Alan's... as if Alan's mind works on logical rails.
You'll be found guilty of that. Stole me bike. You what? I don't know.
I don't even know what it is.
Don't know what it is.
It should be just enough sugar to get your mind to tell the difference between somebody murdering a Spaniard and stealing a bike.
Before the invention of the bike.
Yeah, exactly. All right.
Let's just do the question again. Come on.
No, 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 no. You don't get away with it that easily. Anyway, moving on. Why should you never leave a judge in a room on his own?
He might sentence himself.
As it were.
As it were, yeah.
As it were, yeah.
Well, you're not allowed to. Well, if you're a barrister, you're not allowed to.
That's right.
I used to work at the Crown Courts in Manchester and as a the accused. quite a bit. No, I used to. My dad and auntie were stenographers, so I used to do like over the summer.
Oh, they used those machines.
Yeah, that sort of palaver. And if you were the last barrister knocking about, you weren't allowed to leave if the judge was still in.
Exactly right. Yeah. It's called dressing the judge. You don't actually dress him, it's just known as dressing the judge. They're a smug looking lot there, aren't they?
They look one of the backs had a lovely moment.
He really is. It's a bit of a bliss out, isn't it? He's really very happy. But in fact, in actual terms of dressing a judge, it's a very expensive business. The High Court judge's attire can amount to £14,920. That's quite expensive for your work gear. It includes the cost of two scarlet robes, like this, and a silk one. The horsehair wig costs £1,295. They have court breeches with buckles at £665.
Stockings, suspenders.
Yeah, well, they do have to wear stockings.
Bras.
When you take silk, you have to wear two pairs of stockings as a barrister. And the reason for that is that Queen Victoria was very offended by the sight of men's hairs sticking out from their legs through the silk tights.
That is
so
horrible.
They had to wear two pairs of tights so their hairs didn't stick out. And this tradition continues to the day. Isn't that interesting? Wow. Yes, it is, Stephen. Thank you. Good.
But the wig sort of doubles up now because, I mean, I don't know if it's always been the case, but in a sort of Superman-type disguise, like, if you ever see a judge out of his wig and robe, and he looks completely different. So he can sort of have a little wander around Manchester City Centre, even though everyone hates him and no one knows that.
That is one of the reasons they cling on to this whole business. They say it does give them a kind of anonymity.
Barristers are not allowed to shake hands with each other either.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah,
that's
they're not allowed to shake hands with each other.
Well, they fist pump, do they?
You see? Oh, out of court, they don't shake hands with each other.
Interesting.
I think it must be down to just if he's looking after me, I don't want to see him.
Yeah, I guess.
Fraternising with the enemy. Sort
but
of thing.
Do you know about this one? You might do it if you're not properly dressed as a barrister. If you've not got the right black and white, or you're wearing a colourful tie or something like that, the judge, as it were, can't see you.
All right.
Yeah, she says, I cannot see you. Also, I cannot hear you. If he's not properly dressed, I cannot hear you. You can shout as loud as you like. If he's not properly dressed, can't see you, can't hear you. All of that. So that until they wear the right clothes, they cannot be seen or heard by the judge.
It'd be a weird situation if you didn't know what item of clothing you had on that was offending him.
Yes.
And you'd be going, is it the bow tie? Is it the... And then, like, the second you took it off, he went, hello!
Well, there was...
there you are!
Anyway, now, what happened when the biggest miser in the land forgot his reading glasses?
He made an error in which he gave away his fortune or something happened.
No, because he'd forgotten his glasses, he wasn't able to sign a document because he couldn't see. So he said, I'll take the document, I'll sign it at home. What might that document
his
have
will,
been?
Maybe?
His will. Yes. So, there he's got his will. He said, oh, I can't... I'll take it home and sign it at home. Got home.
Died.
Yes. Oh. Now, that case... his name was Jennens, and he was very, very rich. And he had quite a lot of family. So there was a case called Jennens v. Jennens, or as a lawyer would say, Jennens and Jennens. And it started in 1798 when he died, and it ended in 1915.
Wow.
Why did it end?
The jury all died.
No. Well,
the Jennings died.
No.
Oh, they found his glasses.
Because. He died for the same reason that the fictional version of this case that Charles Dickens made famous in his novel Bleak House, Jarndyce versus Jarndyce, which he based exactly on this story, for the same reason. The estate ran out of money. The lawyers had used up every penny of the estate. That's, doesn't that tell you everything you need to know? And Bleak House, of course, which is one of Dickens' absolute masterpieces, has this court case running through it, Jarndyce versus Jarndyce. And it's been going for dozens of years in Chancery. But he wrote that in 1852. And this Jennens case had been going on for 54 years. And Dickens was little to know that it was to carry on going till the First World War. I mean, it's staggering, isn't it? And all because the man forgot to sign his will. These people were so desperate, so rapacious.
We didn't forget that people... he died. Well,
here they are.
There they are.
I know. Must be very good glasses are going to help you read that book.
Yeah.
Have you done your will? Have you had that chat? It's actually depressing. Well, you had a lady come round to the house and I sat down with her, and because she's so used to talking about death,
yeah,
she's sort of like not bothered about it.
Nonchalant.
Yeah, I'd say so. And she sat there and she said, right, so if you die, where do you want, you know, your money and house and all that to go to? I said, well, the wife and the kids and that. She said, and what if you and your wife both die? I said,
did he?
I said, well, just, you know, the kids, and then, you know, maybe the kids go with my brother and that. And then she said, and if you and
the whole family
and the kids
are
all wiped out. I said, I'd like to spend some money on some sort of inquest. See what the hell went on? Wiped a family of five off the planet.
Mine was a bit more circumspect. They kept finding different words for die. They were, any of you both go?
Perish.
We were both gathered to the bosom of Abraham. Well, I suppose that's their job, isn't it? Basically, no, yeah. I think I've better. Well, I can't remember. You can have my collection of Wagner records.
Oh, thanks.
Make him sign it now.
He'd be very keen for me not to sign it, I suspect. Now, he was considered the richest commoner in the land, i.e., the richest non-aristocrat. And he lived in Grosvenor Square in a very sumptuous and beautiful house, except he lived in two tiny little rooms in the cellar. And he kept the sumptuous rooms because he charged visitors to be shown around them. Brilliant. That's how much of a miser he was.
If only three ghosts was a visited him. We'd have sorted that. Biggest turkey in a window.
Exactly right, exactly. Tiny Tim, last of all. Anyway, where would you find a precocious toddler, a fertile octogenarian, and a moron in a hurry?
Is that on...
Buckingham Palace.
Oh!
Like Celebrity Big Brother.
Are they calling Lee Evans a moron there? That seems very tough.
He's a precocious toddler, isn't
that? Oh, I see. Phew! Again, this is in law. A moron in a hurry.
Well, we've all been that.
Yes, we have. These are sort of fictional types of people.
That they use in law.
That they use in law. The most famous one is the man on the Clapham...
Omnibus.
I.e. what we would call the man... No, it's not. It's just the man in the street. English common law is based on the idea of the reasonable man. What would a reasonable person think? You know, the man on the Clapham omnibus is not stupid, but he's not a professor of astrophysics. He's not a moron in a hurry. He's just an ordinary, sensible citizen. And that is used as a standard by judges. And a moron in a hurry is used as a standard for another kind of problem in law that might come up. It's in the area of passing off. Do you know what I mean by passing off?
Like logos or something.
Yeah, so, like, expand.
Almost like false advertising. Or maybe plagiarism.
That's more like it. As it were, product plagiarism.
Yes.
Suppose I brought out something called Boca Bola, and it was in a can exactly like, with the same lettering and the same patterning.
So would
that
would
be against the law. A moron in a hurry probably... Would he notice that? If it was green, not red, he would notice. Even a moron in a hurry would notice. That would not count as passing off. Right. But if it was very similar and he thought, oh, I'm buying a bad can of Coke, that's passing off, you know, because you don't have to look very hard. You can just quickly see it seems to be the same thing.
Right.
So that's just used as a sort of type.
Got to be careful there because you've also got people who are not very observant.
Well, there is that.
You know, I mean, that's me.
Are you not an observant person?
Well, yes, when I was in the army, there was an observation trail we had to do and you had to walk through the bush and they put all these things that you had to go through and have a look, and then when you came out the other end of the bush, the sergeant would ask you, okay, what sort of things did you see? And I told him I saw three things, including the cone, which marked the exit. So it was really just two things I saw. And there was 17 things in the bush. And one of those was a tank. you know, my excuse was a lot of it was camouflaged.
Yeah. That's good.
But I'm not a moron in a hurry.
No.
Because I took a long
You're
time.
A moron.
Three times the length of time.
A casual moron, yeah. Yes.
So you'd be a fertile octogenarian then, in that.
Yes. Well, the fertile octogenarian is a fictitious character that presumes that anyone, even an octogenarian, can parent a child. So they're these kind of archetypes. And
what's the kid? Why is she in a mood?
Because she's a toddler. Like a fertile octogenarian at the other end of the scale.
Oh, okay.
To be Goodness. Fair, she's not a toddler. She's a bit older than that.
She is. She looks jolly cross, doesn't she? Jolly cross. Anyway, not in the realm of fiction and certainly not legal. Can you explain this? Two people claim to have had sex on the moon. Who are they? How did they do it?
Well, they're clearly under the moon.
Yes.
That's amazing.
So, yes, they are rather, aren't they?
We can run it. So it's not Armstrong and Aldrin.
Well, we hope not. So it's not the astronauts.
So it's no one that's actually been there. It's
not on the moon itself. But are there any bits
moon
of the
rock?
Moon on Earth?
Yeah, moon rock.
Yes.
In the spring of 2002, an intern at NASA at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, three interns, stole the whole safe full of rock samples there. The ringleader, Thad Roberts, and his accomplice, with the wonderful name of Tiffany Fowler, apparently spread the rocks on a bed and did it on the rocks.
That doesn't sound... It's horrible.
They got the rocks off on the rocks. I don't know how you'd say it. It does sound uncomfortable.
It does sound terrible.
But it's certainly unique. I don't suppose any other couple on Earth can claim to have shagged on the moon, or at least on bits of the moon.
I think I own a bit of the moon.
You own a bit of the moon?
Yeah, someone got it me once for my birthday.
Oh, it's like having a star named
I don't know how legitimate it is. I'm just waiting for Branson to sort it out.
Yes.
Then I'll go up there and have a little look.
You'll probably know more about this than I do, but Virgin Galactic is not the only company that's seeking to offer at least a journey out of the atmosphere.
Yeah.
But it'll be quite a short time out of the atmosphere, won't
it? Yeah, you're there for a few minutes.
It'll cost a lot, but would you consider doing it?
I would.
You'd love to see it. Yeah.
It's more of a thrill ride, isn't it? About 2.5 minutes, and then you're coming down.
Like the vomit comet, which is the way you plunge.
That.
Have you done that
which
with the mine? Oh, yes, you did on your show.
Yeah.
So you did, yes, absolutely.
And that's remarkable.
I have to say, I watched it and I admired you did very well. But I was really admiring the cameraman.
Spinning around.
Yeah, managing to keep you in shot.
Yeah,
it can't have been easy.
But there will be bits of the moon other than the bits that were brought back on the surface of the Earth. There's quite a lot of moon and Mars because you get meteorites that enter the Earth's atmosphere. And it may be apocryphal, but the story of a piece of Mars hitting a dog in Egypt and killing the dog. Yeah, what are the chances of the unlucky dog? It's one of the Martian meteorites, one of the famous Martian meteorites.
And it presumably ended his life.
Yes.
Coming in at quite a speed. Quite a
leak. Go, bonk.
There's also a story of a woman whose leg was broken by a meteorite. He was in bed and one came through her roof and broke her leg.
Brian, is the moon the same all the way through or is the surface different from the rest of it?
It's not got an iron core because it's thought to have been blasted off the edge of the Earth by a collision early on in the formation of the solar system.
Did they go down very far, the Apollo astronauts, when they were collecting samples?
No, they just scooped it off the surface.
Into a sack and off they went.
Yeah. That's some of the evidence that tells you that the moon was blasted off the Earth at some point in the past because the composition of the rock is very similar.
Anyway, I should point out that this story that Thad Roberts tells of shagging on the moon, not everybody believes him. Some people think he's just a big old show-off and it's not true. But he certainly claims it, and so who knows. And finally, why would I encourage a psychopath to eyeball my crotch?
Look at that picture.
Wow. This is one of those that I don't think we want to know the real answer.
No.
Nice idea.
Would it release the tension?
Well, I'm afraid we're back in the weird world of the 1960s and then we're in the world of theoretical psychiatry. And it won't surprise you to learn that it was in California there was a psychologist called Paul Bindrim who pioneered nude psychotherapy in 1967 at a nudist resort. And he devised discomforting exercises, one of which was called crotch eyeballing, in which participants were instructed to look at each other's genitals and disclose the sexual experiences they felt most guilty about while lying naked in a circle with their legs in the air. I'm afraid there was a doctor at Oak Ridge Hospital for the Criminally Insane, a Canadian psychiatrist called Elliot Barker, who did a marathon nude psychotherapy session for criminal psychopaths. These raw, naked, LSD-fueled sessions lasted 11 days.
Wow.
11 days, you give a psychopath LSD, take their clothes off, and...
But I believe in evidence-based medicine, so if that can be shown to work, it should be available on the NHS.
I agree.
It doesn't matter.
You're right.
How ridiculous.
You're so
it is.
Right. I, too, am an empiricist like you. Mm. You'll be pleased to know that the average rate of recidivism amongst psychopaths is 60%. Amongst those who did that program, it was 80%.
There we are. Therefore, so
we think it's a
case.
Bad idea. Recidivism.
Oh, I see. Oh, I see.
Recidivism is when you do it the crime again. But why don't we try it? Let's get up. Let's all get up and show each other our genitals.
Come on.
A lot of people getting cameras out. That's a bit. We're in social networking.
He's got a very long telephoto lens as well. It's insulting.
You won't see mine from there. You'll have to come here.
Maybe the audience can take their clothes off as well. Do you feel good about that?
Yeah, I feel more comfortable.
OK. No, I hope the BBC lets us show this moment. So, one, two,
trousers
three.
Trousers
off. Oh, dear, we seem to have a technical problem. We're working to fix that as soon as we can. And good, it's fixed now, so let's get straight back to QI. Hopefully we haven't missed anything quite interesting.
That was very good. That went well. I thought that was very, very good. That was very interesting. Yeah. Very interesting. I can see why they call you Brian Cox now.
Yes.
And a blue one is
yeah,
so
weird. Yeah, no, all right. Anyway, we've learnt a lot about each other and about the audience. Thank you for participating as well, audience. It was very interesting. It was very revealing. And talking of revealing, there is something, after all, to be said for crotch eyeballing. There's a lot more to be said for score eyeballing. And my goodness me, do we have some scores for you today. It's hard to believe that a man of such intellect should be in last place, but I'm sorry to say, on minus seven, it's Brian Cox! Oh.
It's an honour.
And, on minus two, Jason. Jason Oh dear. In second place, with a magnificent plus score of three, is Rhys Darby.
Oh, thank you.
And can we believe it, ladies and gentlemen, with a towering 5 inches, I mean, sorry, a towering 5 points, Alan Davis! To me to thank Rhys, Jason, Brian and Alan, and may God have mercy on your souls. Good night.
Still to come here on BBC HD, we get the true story of the wonderful Wizard of Oz and the many sides of creator L. Frank Baum.